What's up, everyone? It's your boy BlazeDxENFERNO.
And I'm Eknight117, and you are listening to episode 71 of the ENFERNAL Gaming Podcast.
We're recording this episode October 22nd. I mean, just a couple hours before I get up here and stream Resident Evil Revelations over at twitch.tv/BlazeXFerno. Shameless plug. Yeah, I mean,
shame.
But we got a good episode for y'all as always, man. Dope ass episode, man. Might be a little short, but a dope one. If you're new to the show, just know you can listen to us on YouTube, Spotify, and Apple Podcasts, and more. Links are in the description below. Check out our personal links as well. Remember to rate the show 5 stars on Apple and Spotify, and make sure you like the video version if you're watching the video version. You're going to see a little bit of some things different this episode with the video version. I'm going to start trying some different things. I think I'm gonna put like some old VODs up in the background, something for y'all to just watch while you listen to the podcast, if that's your type of thing. I mean, just something to put up on the screen. If not this episode, it's gonna be the next one. But I am trying to do something different for YouTube.
Generic gameplay video that's muted in the background.
Yeah, just in the background, man. I might just throw a random GIF up and just, you know, have that play over and over and over and over again. I mean, who knows, dog? Who knows? But just try some new things out. I mean, we 71 episodes deep at this point. Thank you guys for all the love on the last episode. Y'all been showing mad love. I know y'all been waiting for it. That's why the episode was so fucking long, 3 hours long. I mean, me and Warren really did our thing. So shout out to Warren, man. But today we got a gaming episode for you today. And to be honest, gaming is kind of like, I want to say it's dry. Like, this is the peak. This is literally peak season. Like, but we're like either, okay, so Spider-Man just dropped Friday. Mm-hmm. All right. We got the Metal Gear Collection coming out Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And then in 2 weeks from now, we got Modern Warfare 3. So we're like, right now we are in peak of like the gaming season for the year. So, this is going to be kind of like a chiller episode. We're not going to talk about Spider-Man this episode. We'll talk about it on the next one, because I didn't even buy it yet because I just been busy doing other shit this weekend. And I have other games to play. I've been playing Assassin's Creed Mirage, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But yeah, man, we're in the peak gaming season right now.
Let me ask you this. What have you been playing besides Mirage?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, it's spooky season, so we've been playing a lot of spooky games. We just finished Resident Evil 7 on stream. We're going to do Resident Evil Revelations 2 tonight. Hopefully, we'll beat that tonight. We're almost done Resident Evil 5 on stream. But what I've been, like, really playing, like, Mirage, a lot of Duty, of course. Yeah. A lot of DMZ. I actually just got fucking, I got a voice band, dog.
What? How?
I got a fucking voice band.
I'm not going to ask you to repeat what you said.
The crazy thing is, this time, I didn't say nothing. Somebody else on my team said something, and
it was a group ban.
Yeah, so
damn.
It had to be Thursday. It had to be Thursday. I caught the ban, and I didn't notice until Saturday when I was trying to play with my one boy. He's on Xbox. I'm on PlayStation, but he doesn't have Discord, so you know we just talk through game chat and
He couldn't talk to me.
Yeah. And I was like, what the fuck? So I go and check to make sure my voice settings are good. And it just said, like, you know, I've been prohibited from using public voice channels.
Are you permanently banned, or is it like?
Nah, it's 5 days. So
I'll be back
up Tuesday. But the first two times I got a warning was my fault. You know, first time I told a motherfucker to, you know, eat my dick. You know what I mean? The second time I told a motherfucker he was a pussy and he's a bitch. You know what I mean? Eat my dick. And the third time The third time, I won't even lie, my man dropped the F, but the F word, man.
No, he
dropped the F word.
And you can't do that.
I was like, man, you gonna catch a ban, and I end up catching this shit. He ain't got nothing, so just like
that's crazy.
Yeah, he got a warning. I got a, you know, a
because you were squatted up with him. So actually, I do want to kind of pry into that. Is this the AI shit, or is this just players reporting it?
This is players reporting it.
Because, I know they're trying to do AI stuff with
those guys I know the first times I got reported, those guys were definitely salty because I was trolling. And then I was playing with my coworker the second time I got a warning, and he got a warning as well at the same time. We both got it at the same time. And both of us were like, wow, you really reported us for that shit? Like, man, you a fucking pussy. Like, I mean, but we reported him back, and then it told me that, like, yo, thank you for keeping the community safe and shit. I'm like, well, yo, this shit is so weird, man.
I think it's too, it's probably because it's new, so it's, they're going to be working out a lot of the kinks. And I think it's dropping curse words and calling each other's names is normal trash talk. I don't think it's anything wrong with it. Now, like, racial slurs and shit like that you should probably catch a ban. I'm going to be honest with you. Like, you probably need to chill out with that. That would be like,
yeah, my man definitely dropped that F word, dog. He dropped that. Can't be doing that. That man said that shit. I was like, yo, what the fuck, man? Like, I wasn't streaming or nothing, so I didn't like really care, but it was just like, yo, you probably shouldn't be saying that, but didn't.
Yeah,
we just caught that fucking.
But it is interesting because seeing people getting actually banned for voice chat instead of like text chat, because text chat's usually where it's at, where people catch bans, and voice chat, I don't know. There has to be 1,000 reports per day. I know Valorant,
they use the AI for the voice.
Like Duty also uses that because there's no way they're going to be manually reviewing every report.
Yeah, of course. Man, listen, dog, I ain't going to lie to you. I don't care. I'll be back on Tuesday talking shit again.
All right.
I'll be back on Tuesday, man. Listen. I'm still playing DMZ because, like, one thing about it, DMZ is like my favorite thing to do, like when I'm just like chilling. Now that I got Game Pass, I was telling you before we started the podcast, I got Game Pass again, so I could play the new Forza, but I'm gonna try to, you know, get into these other games. But I'm either going to pick up Spider-Man either tomorrow or Friday, so like I said, by the next podcast, you know, we'll be able to talk about Spider-Man 2. I've heard good things, and I've heard, like, not so good things. And then I heard, like, I just literally heard it's, like, the same game. And I watched a couple people stream it, and I was like, yeah, it's...
I've seen a few like clips here and there, and there's some interesting things that I'd be like, maybe I would play it. But I'm not a huge, like, fan of superhero games, so it's very hard for me to, like, want to just play the shit out of a game like that.
Yeah, I thought 2018 was really good. I thought Miles Morales is really good too, but the only thing about Miles Morales is it's like a standalone DLC. So it was like $30. It was 8 hours long. It was like $40, maybe even more than that.
No, I'm pretty sure it was like $39 probably.
I think it was like $40, and it was like only like 6 to 8 hours long. So it's like you could beat it in like a nice little sit down, but
yeah. I don't know. Yeah. I think the last superhero game, I think I did play like the first Spider-Man that Insomniac dropped on the PlayStation 4. Mm-hmm. But I think the last like superhero game that I was actually into was Infamous Second Son. That one was pretty good.
Yeah, 2018 Spider-Man was really good because all it did was take the mechanics of Batman and make it make it fit Spider-Man. And they did a really good job with it. So I'm excited to play. It's just, I'm more excited to play something else that we'll talk about a little later.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what I've been, we've been doing Gotham Knights with Warren when we can. We'll probably be bringing that back this week sometime. Probably next Sunday we'll go back to Gotham City and, you know, save people and shit like that. And, you know, I've been enjoying that game. And I think it's only because we all played, we only... all three of us only paid like $20 for it. So it's basically we didn't care. Yeah.
You didn't pay full price for when it dropped, and it was like a shit show. Yeah. It came out.
Yeah. You know, as y'all know, if y'all follow me on Twitch, we did Resident Evil 4 remake Separate Ways. That was pretty dope. Nice DLC. You know, nice, solid DLC for $10. You know, Capcom's weird with the way they do things. You know what I mean? And what people swore was going to be a free DLC, and then they were just like, nah, it's like $10. And it was like, people still complained. And I was like, I get why you're complaining, but at the same time, it's $10. Like, it's not that bad, dog. Like,
battle pass money.
It's a cheesesteak, dog. In Philly, that's a cheesesteak. Like, I mean, I don't
like
really
$10 for just the cheesesteak. Because if
inflation is high,
you need to do something about that.
Inflation is high. But what you been playing, man? I'm kind of curious. I mean, what you been playing, dog?
You want to know what I've been playing? You really gonna ask this question? That the obvious answer is I've been playing fucking Halo.
Yeah.
Season 5 finally dropped. And I'm fucking ecstatic. I made a map. Dude, I went into Forge and actually made a map. I learned how to do scripting. Like, you don't understand. Season 5 is goated. Fucking AI is in there. We got firefight. We got flood fucking cosmetics. I can put my helmet on any armor core now, which is like a minor thing. They put a red dot sight on the DMR. Okay.
Whoa, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's called the DMR Evo. It's fucking the same fucking gun. It's literally the same
gun.
It's just got a scope now. It's got like a one point five times sight, and it you scope in now and you get de-scoped when you zoom in. But it's a lot more accurate than the DMR. So I'm not complaining. Fucking great maps. Yeah, I just got done playing a battle royale, an updated version of the battle royale that people made in Forge. Now it has AI in it. It's a randomly generated, procedurally generated, apparently, terrain, is what they showed on their trailer. It's like a smaller version of, it's about the size of Rebirth, I would say, in Call of Duty. So, but you spawn in, you drop down, you go fight AIs for the weapons and shit, and you go do, it's just battle royale shit. And I just played it and I was like, it's great. Yeah, no, I saved all the game types so we can play it anytime we do like a whole like community night or something like that.
We might have to bring back, what was that? Custom nights. We might have to bring that back
for sure.
Let's set it up one of these weekends. I know, not to cut you off, I know we're going to be doing an Apex custom lobby very soon. If not this weekend, the weekend after, we're going to be setting it up because we did a little trial run. It was like me, Augie, Crazy, Chaotic, Necro. And it was a lot of fun, dog. It was.
Like, I'm surprised that they don't have like just custom lobbies in general. Like I know some Twitch streamers can have access to custom servers.
Since season 16, it's custom for everybody.
You can just make
custom rooms. Yeah. As long as you need six people to start a room.
Got it. So they're trying to save on server space.
I think you need 12 people to do anything that's not like TDM, gun run, all that. So if you want to do like battle royale, I think you need 12 people. But if you want to just do like team deathmatch and gun
like
run
arena
and all that shit.
Yeah,
it's only six people. So
I gotta check out Apex again because like I pretty much was done after what, season 13?
Yeah. We'll talk about that later too because I've been meaning to say that for the past. Couple episodes, but
fucking
season
5. We also got two new maps. One of them has an actual environmental like hazards to worry about. They got, it's like a needler cave, you know, like the crystals on the needler.
Yeah,
they put little pockets of crystals everywhere. So if you shoot them, they blow up, and then like they're pretty much like a needler and they go after people. I also like the fact that now they're highlighting particular campaign weapons, like the pinpoint needler is the power weapon on that map. And I'm like, it is actually a really fucking good gun because it just auto locks on everybody. But map flow is nice. They also have the other map, which is like a ancient forest temple. It's a really big 4v4 map, and it's really great for sniping. There's also like an Easter egg on there for infection, where if you hit all these little symbols on the floor, you'll open up a secret room with a weapon called the sandwich, and you just grab a sandwich and beat the shit out of people. Yeah, it's fucking dope. Like, I like this. Whatever team 343 has now, they're doing it right. It's doing good. So we got Battle Pass, by the way, is only 50 tiers, but it's all mostly cosmetics. So like actual armor pieces, and then also like money, and then you have your obligatory like stickers and shit. And then they cleaned up the main menu. It's all cleaned up. Servers have been pretty smooth. There was a little hiccup I had when I tried streaming it the day of, because the download took forever to do. It's been fun since. Like, I've been finding great custom games. The Forge AI is actually really good. It's pretty tight. You can basically have them like, you have like 32 AIs on the field at all times. So you can like basically recreate Warzone from Halo 5. You can make your own campaign missions, because there's like I was telling you earlier, I was doing scripting, and fucking I figured out how to do triggers, which will like, you know, you can only have 32 AI on the map at a time, but if you kill them and progress throughout the map, I can add more. So I added these triggers throughout the map. So basically it's like a small pseudo game design kit. And like, you can have elites coming out. You got drop pods for like the Covenant. You can have Marines follow you around and shit. Like, it's pretty much, they just took all the AI from campaign and threw it in multiplayer. And then later this season, we're supposed to get the repair tool, which is supposed to it's like the regenerator from Halo 3, but it also fixes vehicles.
Okay.
And then after that, and then around that same time, we're supposed to get what's it called? King of the Hill Firefight as like an official game type, which I think it's like a 4v4 firefight game mode. But the firefight game mode is technically in the Forge file. So people have been creating firefight game modes. I played one on a new Mombasa map where it's like the first mission in the city on Halo 2. Pretty much just fighting like a bunch of waves of Covenant. You got someone recreated the Storm from Halo 3. You got a Scarab. I haven't played it, but I saw it, and I'm curious to see if the Scarab is actually functional, like it moves around or some shit. Like, there's a lot going on in like just the custom and forging community in Halo Infinite, and it's like, it's a good thing. It's like a revitalization of the game, and I'm here for it.
Yeah, something that game definitely needs too.
Yeah, so it's starting to cement itself as one of the, I don't want to say the best, because it's never going to be the best Halo, but it's going to cement itself as like a good pinnacle growth for 343's entries in the Halo series.
Yeah, especially for them, because they haven't had a dub.
They really haven't. Like, Halo 4 to me is like one of the worst ones multiplayer wise. Story was okay, but the story's okay. But that's just the story.
A year or two ago, again for the first time, and I was like, I'm not gonna lie, like this story is not like that bad. I just think it's
the campaign itself, corny. Like the missions and the
missions are kind of fun. Like that third mission when you're in the elephant and shit.
Just a big elephant. I was like, yeah, it's cool. But the thing is like the enemies, like the knights are not fun to fight. A lot of them are just annoying as shit. And like when you play that shit on legendary, it's like just annoying. Like I beat the game on legendary. I was like, this is just stupid. Like I'm just dying to the stupidest shit rather than it being like, oh man, like I can actually like figure out this dude. It's like, no, this dude has like all the kits and gizmos and I kill him. Then he comes back to life. I'm like, oh motherfucker. Like I have no ammo because there's no ammo on no guns on this fucking map. That's the level design wasn't like the cooler missions were the more scripted linear missions, like the Death Star run at the end and then the fucking mammoth. But like everything else was just like mid or like not that great. It's in a good place now. I'm excited to see what they do mid season, what type of events. I suggest everybody that kind of put Halo Infinite on the back burner, you can come back. All those battle passes you missed, you can just get them for $10 each. They're still there. You didn't miss out on any real cosmetics, yeah, except for maybe some cosmetic events. But I've been here for like every single event, so I have like pretty much damn near everything in terms of those free events.
There might be their saving grace with that too, is that you can just, because they know like a lot of people missed out, now they can come back and you know they can spend that
whoever,
money on them.
Whoever decided that is probably the smartest man in the world, because he probably just saved them or made them a lot of money for people who came back and just started buying the battle passes, and now they can just work on cosmetics.
Yeah.
I know there was some upset when they technically expire, all the free items for that current battle pass go back to being paid because you have to pay for it, but it's like, it's whatever. I mean, like, it's $10 at the end of the day. It's not that, it's a Philly cheesesteak.
Facts. Big facts. Yeah. I'm glad you're starting to think that way.
I mean, to me, I think Apex and the rest of those games that run battle passes that expire would be, they'd make more money if they didn't expire, is my point.
Yeah.
I don't see the unless you're selling your account, I don't see the prominence of having exclusive content. I know there's fear of missing out, but it's like, there's too many damn battle passes. So, like, just save them. Fuck it. I'll pay for it later.
Now, you ain't lying, man. Listen, I'll keep it real with y'all, right? I recently came back to Halo 5 as Eknight knows. I came back during the Tenrai event because, you know, I really enjoy
Halo 5.
No, I mean Halo Infinite shit.
I was about to say, damn, they're still running events on 5? Fuck.
Nah. But yeah, we got up on that together, me and him. And
yeah, that was fun.
We had a great time. And I even grinded it like off stream and was playing it with a Coyote, shout Coyote, and a couple other people. And I was like, wow, like this is really fun. And then it just turned into like every once in a while, like maybe like on a Saturday night when I'm not streaming or something, me and the guys will get on Halo Infinite and we'll run a couple games. And like I said, it's been a very fun experience, dog. Like it's I want to call like a breath of fresh air, man. Like it's like it feels good to play the game again. And it's like one of those things where it's like the progression they fixed. They did that a couple seasons ago.
Oh, big thing that I forgot about that. If you hit hero rank, you get Master Chief armor from the campaign.
Oh, okay. Did you hit that yet?
No, I'm not hero rank yet. They just introduced that last season, so I've been casually. I'm like in the gold, so I'm like halfway there.
Okay. Yeah. A lot of people were excited that they brought the ranks back and shit.
Yeah, I mean, like it's to me, it's like basic player stat tracking, and a lot of people invest a lot of time in these types of games. Like Call of Duty has its own KD and shit. So like some people like to show it off. I personally don't care. I think it's interesting if I look at like my play times, like back when Bungie granted, you'd go on the BNet and see how much time you spend in campaign or custom games or Forge or matchmaking. And it's a little like pie chart that they had going on. I was like, you know, this is interesting. Like I really enjoy this, playing this more than I do anything else. And it's like you kind of just get an idea that some people prefer certain communities in the Halo sphere. So I'm interested in seeing what they do next. If it's going to be good, if it's just going to be kind of like a chill out because they just did all this stuff with AI or the Forge AI. So like, I don't know. I think we're damn near close to just being able to create our own campaign missions. And I'm for it. I'm here for it.
Okay. Yeah. I'd like, me personally, man, I really wanted Halo Infinite to win when it first came out. Like I really wanted that shit to win. And I was disappointed like everybody else was. Yep. But I do agree with Eknight that this is the game that you can definitely safely come back to this and enjoy yourself and have a great time. Like all the problems we had, like no playlists, we got that now. We got Forge. We got a lot of creativity with Forge.
Mm-hmm.
They fixed the progression with the battle pass. Like I said, it's like I went from like on my one battle pass, I went from tier 37 to like 47 with or like 49 by just playing like casually, like not even trying to do like the things that it wants me to do, just like just by having fun. And that was one of my biggest problems with it at first, was like it makes you do very specific things that kind of just take you out of like Halo really is, you know, like Apex has that same system with their battle pass system. Like you earn stars by, you know, play this character a certain amount of times, get a certain amount of kills with this character, you know.
No, they really fixed the battle, the challenge system in Halo, because like I'll be playing the game and I'll be, oh, maybe I'll work on my challenges, and I'll look up and I'm like already done the ultimate. I'm like, oh, cool. I'm just casually beating this shit and not even realizing it.
Yeah, and that's I think for like a game like Halo, that's necessary. Like a game like Call of Duty, a game like Apex, that's different. Like, all right, go kill, you know, 20 people with shotguns, or go do this, or go do that. Works for those types of games, because not only for a lot of those challenges, you might just do them passively, but it's just one of those things where it's just like, it's something that you can do within the game. Like, I know at Apex, when you get to like the higher levels of the battle pass, like for me, it's usually when I get to like tier 60 or like tier 70, that's when I got to really start focusing on the challenges, because I've kind of done all of the ones that I would do passively. So now it's like, all right, it's time to do the ones that.
And that's where I was like, battle passes turn into work at that point. Cause it's like, now I'm not playing the game to have fun or like beat people in a competitive sense. Now I'm playing the game because I have work to do.
I think with Apex, it's not to take away from like the conversation that we're having. Mm-hmm. I think with Apex, why I like it so much is because I feel like with Apex, it like allows me to play differently. Cause like Apex is one of those games where it's like, if you're somebody like me, you play the same like 2-3 legends all the time. You go for the same 2 or 3 guns all the time. Like, oh, I really like the Spitfire. I'm always looking for a Spitfire. I always like this gun. I'm always looking for it. So like their challenge is just kind of be like, all right, play Bangalore for 10 games. All right, I'll do that. I mean, I'll switch the legend up real quick. Get, 10 kills with the R99. All right, I'll give that a try. You know what I mean? Just certain little things that might just switch up your gameplay enough to make it fresh. That's why I like it in Apex. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's a problem in Apex. A game like Halo, which is like a arcade-style shooter, it doesn't really work because the whole goal of like Halo is just to kind of like play your way. It's like this. Halo is like a huge sandbox. So when you tell people like, no, you're not allowed to dig with the shovel, you got to dig with a rake. It's like, that's not the way I want to.
Yeah, no. So like, in the sandbox, the issue was like that a lot of the challenges are super specific with particular things that weren't always like widely available, because like Halo maps have weapon sets and shit. So like, if there's no heat wave on this map, then it's like, well, damn, I guess I gotta wait till the next match. And it's like by then I already forgot about the challenge, and I'm like, fuck, I forgot about the challenge. But now they're doing like, oh, get a kill with UNSC weapons, or getting a kill with.
Yeah, something weapon. A little less specific.
It's very vague and broad, and it works because I'm a guy that likes to use everything in my power to win when I'm playing the Halo games. So like, I'll just be running around gunning with a BR, and then I'll run out of BR ammo, or I'll pick up like an energy sword, and then I'm just like unstoppable for like 3 seconds until some dude hits me with a rocket launcher. But like, while I'm doing that, I'm earning experience and progression with my challenges. So like, the more vague it is, the more enjoyable the experience is, and I'm getting extra levels in my battle pass that I'm actively working towards at the same time, and I'm not even realize I'm doing it. And I think if all the games with battle passes lean towards that a bit more for the sake of the casual audience, then I think they'll have a lot more better player retention. I feel like like I probably said on previous podcasts, you get done your battle pass and now you're like, well, now what? I'm gonna go play the other game. I have four more battle passes that I paid for and to finish those out. And to me, that's not a fun experience. To me, that's work. I went from my day job and now I'm doing more work at home and I don't want to do work. I want to have fun with the boys. I want to throw plasma grenades. I want to run around with an energy knife and stab the shit out of people. I want to get reported for dropping a 38 bomb on a new map while all the players are playing like bots. Like this is what I want to do. I don't want to focus on doing these challenges. If I want to do challenges, I'll go play an MMO. I'll go play an RPG.
This is correct. I feel you on that.
I don't want to play these competitive shooter games where I just want to play the way that I want to play. The only exception to this rule is challenges that earn me cosmetics in like a non-battle pass sense, something I don't have to pay for. So like, for example, Halo 3 and ODST had the Vidmaster achievement challenge to get the recon armor. Mm-hmm. Every time you got one of those achievements and you unlocked a little bit of the recon armor. And recon armor back in the day was super sought after. You could only get it through Bungie until ODST came out. So that being said, it's like this, that's the only type of challenges I would work towards, something that everyone can totally get, but I don't have to pay for it. And it's not on a weird timed exclusivity window. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I don't want to work when I get off work. I want to go play a game. So
I feel you, man. Like I said, I've come back to Halo Infinite and I enjoyed a lot and I'm having a lot of fun and I'm glad that the game is kind of it's in its second renaissance, man. And it feels good. Mm. Like it feels like, you know, for those people that have always just been a really big Halo fan, like it feels like we finally got the Halo game that we've kind of maybe always wanted. I don't know.
They're slowly revamping that cosmetic system that nobody likes. And every season seems like we're going to getting closer and closer to having like a true customization for all the Spartan cores and shit. I mean, I was surprised we didn't get a Spartan core for the Flood Pass. That's what I was surprised about. Yeah, I was like,
that
damn.
That was something I was surprised you didn't talk about. So they brought the Flood back, right?
No, so it's not the Flood. It's cosmetics about the Flood.
All right, that's still cool, though, because I've seen the helmet with, like, the
Flood. Yeah, one of those is, like, a armor kit, and you're, like, a rhino-looking infected Spartan. And there's a lot more cosmetics you can buy in the shop. Everyone loves these things. All the Halo fans are enjoying these things. I love it, because now I can do cool machinimas with it if my friends decide to shell out money, you know. Hey, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, Blaze, go buy some shit.
I got you, man. I got you. I might clap some shit up. Like I said, I'm back to playing it. So it's like, I'm one of those people that's like, if I'm playing something, like I have no problem with spending money on it. Like I just dropped $20.
But this
yesterday this is, on the fucking Lilith skin for
this is also what I want to say about the can't, you know, how the battle pass at live service games have narratives and shit.
Yeah,
they dropped the narrative for the season. They were just like, it was either focus on the gameplay and get this shit out or a cutscene. And they made the right choice. They went for the fucking gameplay. And
okay. You can't be mad at them for that.
No, I would prefer if they did like red versus blue style fucking cutscenes for these seasons. I would find that would be like hilarious. And I think everyone would probably enjoy that a lot more than these high res, high poly fucking cutscenes that don't mean anything for this fucking live service game to make us feel like we're part of the Halo universe. They could have did something if they did an actual true like firefight or Spartan Ops thing. Mm-hmm. But if it means we're going to get better gameplay for the game, I would rather that than have a narrative. If they give us campaign DLC later, that'd be great. But right now I'm happy with what they put out. And I'm delving deep into this scripting shit for Forge, so like I'm gonna be down for the rabbit hole for a bit with this shit, and then yeah, I'll probably show you some of the stuff I'm working on in the next video that I eventually come out with.
Okay, all right, sounds good, man. I'm here for it, man.
But you know. Do you know what doesn't have its second renaissance or its first renaissance or any type of momentum?
What's that?
This King of Kong game, King Kong game that came out recently. It's like you thought the Golem game was bad. This shit is a walking meme generator. Holy shit. Listen,
the crazy thing is I don't want to talk about this game to like rag on it or like make fun of the developers or anything like that. Like I kind of want to like shed light on like how fucked up the game development world is sometimes. Mm. Because like I just found out like this game is developed in like less than a year.
Yeah.
Like which, way less than a year, which is
the thing is though, dude, I feel like there are indie games that come out not even fully finished in under a year and still probably would have been a better quality than this. Like that's like, it really comes down to who's developing and who, if whether or not they know what they're doing.
And they're charging full price for this shit, which is what the fuck.
Were they? I thought it was like
it's
50.
$40. It's 40. Okay. It's 40.
No, it's not like the Golem game where they charge like 70 for it. And I was like, why the fuck? First of all, I didn't even understand the concept that the game was a stealth game with as Golem. Why would I want to play as Golem?
I've never heard of this developer or this publisher ever. So that's like another thing. Like, is this somebody who just, you know, bid it on the King Kong license? And
it's possible. I don't know. I just know the game is trash.
It's garbage.
Is it a PlayStation exclusive? Is it on everything?
No, it's on Steam. I'm looking at it on Steam right now.
Okay, so. All right. I was about to say, yeah, no, the game is visually wise, it's terrible. Gameplay-wise, it looks boring as shit. There's older King Kong games that have come out that look old and still play way better than this. Yeah, so, man. I don't know what the fuck was going on with the development.
I don't know what's going on. Yeah, I don't know what's going on.
It seems like they spent more money on the artwork for the damn case than fucking the game itself. Because this is my first video game.
I was just looking at the shit.
You see it?
Yeah.
You seen the fucking cover case? I'd be so fucking hurt. The game does not look anything like that.
It's crazy, man.
At first when I saw it, I thought I was like, oh, they're going for like a cartoonish vibe. And I was like, no, it's just bad graphics. This man, Jesus Christ. Yeah. And at one point I saw the cutscene that has just a static frame for one of the bosses you apparently fight, and I was like laughing because it's literally
bosses? What the fuck is, what is this game?
Have you seen that shit?
Nah.
Hold on, let me see if I can find
any,
it. For you.
I didn't see any gameplay or anything.
Yo, it's just a cutscene. That's why it's funny. Because normally cutscenes are like vastly different.
Yeah.
From the actual game itself. Hey, one sec. I'm trying to find it.
There you go, man. Take your time. Take your time. But yeah, man, I'm not going to rag on these guys too long. I feel like it's fun to poke fun at it, but at the same time, like, I don't know, man. I don't know what the fuck they were thinking with this shit.
I don't know, man. Like, it's crazy to me that it's like you just watch. I don't know. Like, I don't know who was like, hey, let's just make this game, and then it comes out and it's like terrible. Like, it's just terrible.
No, I get what you're saying, man.
Like, if the gameplay was good, I'd be like, all right, man, like, you can forgive the graphics, you can forgive the still for the cutscene.
Nah, this shit's kind of hard to forgive, though.
This shit. I was dying when I saw it, man. I gotta find it, man. This shit is hilarious.
But let's segue into something that I forgot to put on the notes, man. I wanted to talk to you about this, man, and see what your thoughts about it were. So before we get into another Activision game, right, I wanted to talk about one in particular that's kind of got some people pissed off. And that would be, shit, what the fuck is going on? That would be Overwatch 2 and their new season. I don't know if you, did you hear the drama with the new season?
With Overwatch 2? No, what happened?
Okay, so for y'all that don't know, all right, like Eknight himself, season 7 of Overwatch 2 came out, and it was actually like the season people were like very excited for, dog. Like, not gonna lie. It's called Rise of Darkness, and it in a lot of their trailers, they showed off some really unique and really cool skins. Mm-hmm. One of them being Lilith from Diablo, a Moira skin as Lilith from Diablo. And then I think the other one is Pharah as a Narsh, the Grim Reaper dude.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like people were kind of excited about this, you know, new season of Overwatch. Like, there's a lot of people that I knew personally that were like, yo, like, I'm coming back. I'm playing Overwatch. I'm going in and stuff. And I'm going to buy this battle pass. I'm going to grind it out until they let us know that, this new season and the skins that people want are locked behind a $40 fucking battle pass. A $40 battle pass, not a $10 battle pass, not so a $20 battle pass.
You're telling me they increased the price of the battle pass, the normal battle pass, not like an exclusive battle pass or anything crazy like that?
That's what it is. So that's what it is. There's a regular battle pass. There's the free battle pass, as you know, where it skips all the good shit and you only get trash. Mm-hmm. And then they got the battle pass that you pay for. And then now they have this premium battle pass, which is only locked behind this ultimate battle pass bundle.
I heard this before. This is fucking Diablo, right? Diablo did this.
Call of Duty did it with Black Cell that I bought for the past 3 seasons.
Jesus Christ, you're part of the problem.
Yo, me and Eric say it all the time. We part of the problem, baby.
You're fucking terrible. You're terrible.
But to be fair.
No. Shut the
fuck
up.
The Black Cell is only $30, though. It's only $30. You get 20 tier skips. You get exclusive skins within the battle pass. So you get all this exclusive shit.
I want you to understand, like, If we were to compare the, you know how, like,
1100 COD points,
bro, you paid for that.
That's cool.
That's just money. That's money you can't use on your cheesesteak.
And I bought it to get the, I used that 1100 plus another 1300 that I got from the battle pass, from grinding out the battle pass, to buy the Lilith skin. I bought the Lilith skin.
So what, dog? You already paid for it.
I can play as Lilith in fucking Warzone now. It's lit.
No. Who gives a fuck?
I like it. It's lit.
Bro, fucking Warzone is just a clusterfuck of IPs trying to be like Fortnite.
Dog, no, you're crazy, man. I ain't gonna lie.
You're last fucking season, wild. No, you're part of the problem.
It got wild when it was like Nicki Minaj and 21 Savage. I bought the Nicki skin. But yeah, this is wild,
I know,
man.
I know why you bought it. Fucking piece of shit.
That's right, man. I got a fat ass. You know what I mean? But yeah, with this battle pass, with this ultimate battle pass bundle, which costs $40, not $30, you get a premium battle pass with 20 tiers, Lilith, Moira, and Inarish Pharah legendary skins, mm-hmm. Pumpkin Bastion epic skin, 2,000 Overwatch coins, so $20 worth of Overwatch coins, mm-hmm. and other season 7 cosmetics, one highlight intro, and 2 sprays. I mean,
okay.
So I know Dr. Kai's bought it. I know a couple other people bought the Ultimate Battle Pass bundle because they play a lot of Overwatch. I don't play enough Overwatch anymore to even like. Nah, I'm just not paying that.
So the free Battle Pass is free. The standard is 10, and then you need to pay an extra 40.
I think the standard now is like 13.
Why?
Because for duty, I think duty the standard now is like 13, but I wouldn't know. I haven't bought a standard battle pass in Call of Duty in
like three seasons. Crazy to me that like this is like one of the most, these are the like most played games in a while, like multiplayer wise, and you're charging the amount of money that people are probably spending for cosmetics.
You can buy a fucking game. You can buy a fucking game.
Yeah.
That's what I was saying when I seen that Battle Pass bundle. I was like, all right, $30, you're pushing it, right? They were pushing it when they first introduced the Black Cell shit in Call of Duty. I was like, okay, the Black Cell shit is lit. The content is cool. But they kind of tripping. And then in season 4, they made it better. In season 4, they're like, all right. We understand all we did was some recolors with last season of the Black Cell shit. We're going to give you some better shit with this Black Cell shit. And they did. I ain't going to lie. Season 4 was, the Black Cell shit was fire, dog. Mm-hmm. Like, it was, everybody was like, they had flames. And there was even like DMZ content like involved and shit. It's pretty dope. It was really good, man, the way they did season 4. Same thing with season 5. This season's really good with the Black Cell shit. I've noticed this season a lot of people have bought the Black Cell shit. Mm-hmm. Cause like I'll see them rocking like the Black Cell gear and like Warzone and DMZ and shit. So I feel like $30, I get what they trying to do, because this is what they do with the Black Cell shit, right?
I'm still,
before Black Cell, it was $10 for the regular battle pass, $20 if you wanted the battle pass plus the 25 tier skips. So that's what I used to pay before, was the $20 joint to get the 25 tier skip, so I can get the new guns right away.
Mm-hmm.
And just be done with it and just passively grind out, because I've completed every battle pass for Modern Warfare 2, everyone. I'm almost done this one. I'm at like 65, so like I get my money's worth out of it, you know what I mean? And then when they introduced the Black Cell, the way I've looked at it in my head was like, you spend another $10 of what I've already been spending, which was $20. I spend another $10, and they give me some exclusive shit for the battle pass that I've already been paying for. And then I get 1,100 COD points that I was already going to buy, because every season I buy a new skin. That's just like something I do in my mind. Okay. I'll buy a new skin every season. So like last season, I bought the Nikki skin. This season, I bought the Lilith skin. You know what I mean? Like, that's just in my mind what I'm going to do. So it works for me. But with this shit, like, I can't wrap my head around that shit. Because to me, to be honest, it's like a slap in the face to the fan base. Because people were only getting excited for this new battle pass because they were like, okay, this is going to be in the regular battle pass. The regular battle pass content that's been dry for seasons. And people have been
the same content that like they put the first one that came out. They were like, the champion is like 50 tiers in.
Like, yeah, it's just like ass. People wanted them to get the battle pass right and get it good. Mm-hmm. And this looked like the season they were going to do that. And they're like, yeah, that gear that y'all liked and stuff like that, that's in the, you know, other battle pass.
That but they waited till after to announce that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, fuck yeah. That's scummy shit. It wasn't like all at once. But like at the same time, it's like, is it $30 to upgrade and it's a 40 total, or is it 40 extra dollars to upgrade to the premium?
I don't know, man. I don't know.
Either way, $40 is outrageous. Even like at that point, you might as well just put the skins in the shop. Like it's like, just, you'd make more money if they were in the shop. Like,
dog, like I said, a YouTuber said this, and I'll say it again. You know it's bad when people are literally begging for loot boxes to come back.
It's been bad for them. They've been begging for that shit to come back since the two came out. So it's like, I don't know. They cancel fucking PvE and they scrap it and give out a few PvE missions. But bro, this Overwatch is like fucking, yeah, I don't know. Man. It's not, it's like I uninstalled the game ages ago. I liked it when it came out, the first one, but like second one was a little smoother, but it's the same game. It's the same game. It boggles my fucking mind that it's the same fucking game and they've slapped a two on it and they're like, hey, we're going to overcharge you on everything now. Like, are you that hurt up for money? Like, do you need bread, bro? Are you good? Like, do you need a loan? Like, what's going on? Like, what's your tax? What's your fucking credit score? What's the matter, Overwatch? Like, what the fuck? Like, I don't know what it is with Activision Blizzard specifically. They're slowly becoming worse. They're becoming a new generation of EA Sports. Like, the fuck? Like, release kind of like the same shit every year. Your game upgrades, you hype up as like a new game. You make false promises. I mean, like, on Steam, is fucking Overwatch still fucking negatively rated?
Yes, on Steam, yes. Hell yeah.
Let me look real quick. Overwatch 2. Free to play game, by the way. It's a solid, overwhelmingly negative.
Yep.
200,000 reviews. God damn. This is a free to play game that has been around since 2016. Like, fuck.
Yeah, man.
That's terrible.
I'm trying to tell y'all. Y'all know it was bad. Y'all knew it was bad when fucking people were begging for fucking loot boxes to come back.
They just need to just keep their promises and not fucking make promises they're not going to keep. Like, that's how you kill the trust in the game. I mean, look, again, Halo Infinite is the best example. They try to hype up the beta as the fucking actual game when it came out. Nothing happened when it came out, and everyone was mad at the shit at them, and that almost killed fucking Halo Infinite. That almost killed 343. Yeah. So, like, you gotta look at it like this. It's like, if you're not, the way Halo Infinite has recovered is because they stopped making promises. They go, hey guys, we're just gonna do this. And then they do it.
Well, like I said, you know, this kind of segueing into the next topic. Well, the next two topics really fast.
Yeah.
But hopefully Blizzard and Activision will be better in the arms of their newly acquired new.
It's finally over.
Person. Yeah, it's finally over, dog. Yeah, you know, I mean, Microsoft has won. They won. They dropped a dope ass trailer to announce.
Like their trailer. It was cool.
That trailer was fucking fire, dog. Because it literally has me thinking of the possibilities, dog. Like, dude, everything that we can now get
is, can you imagine? You can put Master Chief in Call of Duty now.
Dog,
I will play Call of Duty now.
It's about to be lit, dog. I ain't gonna lie.
Put the guy from Fortnite in Call of Duty. I will play it. I will only play it for Master Chief. It's the same way with Siege. Siege put Master Chief in. I don't know who brought that deal over. That was the easiest $30 I dropped in Siege for a long ass
time. My man dropped $30, man.
$30 game skin, and I don't fucking regret it. Not one bit.
For fucking Sledge, right?
Yeah, it's Sledge. Yeah, I don't even play Sledge like that, but now I do.
You're part of the problem too, motherfucker.
First of all, I'm not paying for fucking tier skips. I'm getting exactly what I want.
Hey, man, whatever floats your boat, man. But yeah, Activision is now in the hands of Microsoft, and they've been doing some things. Like, I know, like, for you people who haven't played Diablo 4 yet, I believe this weekend that's currently going on, or next weekend, you'll be able to play Diablo 4 for 10 hours for free, totally free, as long as you have Xbox Live, well, Xbox Game Pass Core, I should call it. The Core is the standard just Xbox Live thing. So, yeah, make sure you guys cop up on that, man.
Yeah, I'm about to get Game Pass now.
I told y'all in the beginning of this podcast, I got Game Pass to play the new Forza And I'm probably going to try Liza P as well. I mean,
Speaking of which, I hope the RoboCop game comes for Game Pass, because then I'll be able to play that.
Yeah. Just a little sidebar, y'all. So a lot of people have been hitting me up about this RoboCop game. It looks good, but it looks like I'd rather play it at like Dave and Buster's. Like, no lie, I'd rather play like this shit.
Arcade game?
Yeah, man, it's like an arcade game. But
I think it's just because it's the style.
Bad. Yeah, it's just the style of it. I'm not saying it's bad, but for you Nintendo Switch only console owners, which, you know, damn.
Yeah, that's...
They canceled the Nintendo Switch version of this game, of RoboCop Rogue City, which I heard, like... Some people like it, some people don't. Like, I heard it was, if you're a fan of RoboCop, which RoboCop is an iconic movie, you know what I mean? Iconic movie. You know what I mean? You might like this game. I think I'm going to get it when it's, like, on sale or something.
Mm-hmm.
I may never get it. Who knows? I might just watch somebody play it on stream. You know what I mean? I'll find a streamer to play it and stuff. But, yeah. But let's get to the meat. This fucking podcast, man. We got like two things to talk about. Two more things. I promised y'all of the Assassin's Creed Mirage review. I'm going to give it to you, man. Real quick. Real short and sweet. It's ARD. It's literally ARD. So Mirage is a game where you play as Bassam, who was introduced in Assassin's Creed Valhalla. He's kind of a big deal in that game, like, without spoiling things, like, he's kind of a big deal in that game. Like, he has like a overwhelming plot in that game, but like, other than that, like, that's it, man. I mean, that's it. So they decided to make a spinoff game, which isn't really a spinoff, because I just feel like they marketed this game like all wrong. And not in a bad way. Well, in a bad way, but like, they try to market this game as being like a successor to like the older games. It was going to go back to its roots. And it's like, it did, but not like all the way. So it's like, all they did was like cut out all the fat that like the RPG games like Origin, Odyssey, and Valhalla introduced, with like the full-blown open world where it's just massive and there's all these different states and continents and worlds and all other types of shit and ship combat and shit. They took all that shit out. They dumbed it down to just one area. You're in Baghdad, which is still pretty big. It's still pretty big, and there's a nice little sandbox to traverse around, and there's a lot of things within it. But it's not like a successor to the older games. Like I said, I feel like they just kind of cut the fat out. They made it to where they brought like notoriety back. You can hide in plain sight again. So if you see like a crowd of people, you can blend in. Yeah, they been took that out.
That's crazy.
Like the whole notoriety thing. So the more like you kill like in the open, you'll have like, you know, people will be more suspicious of you and stuff. They took that out like 7 games ago. They took that shit out back in like Unity or Syndicate. So it's been gone for like 10 years. And they finally brought it back. And it's, and like I said, it's like very watered down. Like I said, they made it less of an emphasis on like combat and more of an emphasis on stealth. But at the same time, the stealth isn't like really hard. Like I haven't done an area yet where it was like, yo, this stealth is like overwhelmingly hard. Like I'm having a difficult time sneaking through here. Like the AI is still brain dead. You know what I mean, it's just...
No, I've seen a couple of clips where, like, a dude will, like, whistle while he's in, like, that, like, little changing booth, or it's, like, a weird, like, booth with, like, a cloth around it, and the dudes will come over, like, huh? And he'll just grab him from in there and kill him, and then another dude will be like, huh? And he'll just do that until he kills, like, everybody in the area. Like, it's kind of mid-tier. Not even mid, like, just not that great.
Yeah, man. Like I said, dog, like... Like, I like the open world, like RPG Assassin's Creed games. I thought Odyssey was like one of the best games of like 2018. Like, no lie. Like, it was a very slept on game. That game was very good. I thought Valhalla was pretty good. It was kind of like really long pause. But I do like Mirage. I just think it's like, it's mid. It's okay. I just think they picked the wrong character. Like, Bassam was never, like I said, he's got like a pivotal point in Valhalla, which takes place like years after Mirage, but it's only because of Eivor in Valhalla. So it's just like, in this game, it's just, we're basically see him grow from a street thief to an initiate assassin to a master assassin. It's just like, they could have picked like a better character, I don't know.
It's an entry. It's not a great Assassin's Creed. It's not the worst Assassin's Creed. It's just Assassin's
it's
Creed.
It's hard. Like I said, it's hard.
It's as good as it's probably gonna get.
I heard it's extremely short. But like, that was the point. But at the same time, it's like, they were like, oh, we're only charging $50 for it instead of $60 or $70. And it's just like, I guess. I don't know. I don't know what they're trying to accomplish with this. Ubisoft has been doing a lot of weird shit, like sidebar X Defiant. We talked about that in the last gaming podcast. That shit got pushed back. Division Heartlands got pushed back. Ubisoft don't know what they're doing right now, man. They don't know what's going on. I don't know, dog. I heard The Crew 2 was okay. It was all right. Even though I heard they lied to everybody about the crossplay. But it's all right. The game's all right. Cyberpunk 2077, since the last podcast, the Phantom Liberty DLC dropped. I bought it and I have not played it yet. And I pre-ordered it. But
that's a good review.
But what came out with the Phantom Liberty DLC was a 2.0 update. And the 2.0 update did a lot of things. It cleaned up the UI. It actually changed the entire skill tree. It changed a lot of different things within the game, like certain systems and stuff. And when Phantom Liberty was coming out, they were urging everybody to basically like replay the game. Like make a new character for Phantom Liberty. So I did that. You know what I mean? And I'm like probably roughly 15 hours in with this new character. And like, I've gotten like a newfound love for Cyberpunk again. And it's like, I'm just about to get to the certain part. Cause you have to play up until a certain point in the main story to play the DLC. So you have to get to the part where like, you're in Pacifica dealing with the voodoo boys and shit. Mm-hmm. Once you complete that, you'll be able to start the DLC. I'm right there. But it's like, it's one of those things where I'm literally just enjoying this update. I'm like really enjoying this update, though. And I like Cyberpunk is kind of getting its like second renaissance that it like, I felt like it doesn't necessarily deserve, but like we've talked about it on countless podcasts. If you want to watch the first 10 episodes from episode 1 to 10, we talk about Cyberpunk in all those episodes. And the one thing I always said was like, this was a game I was very excited for. I was really hyped. I just bought it on the wrong system. I bought it on PS4 and my experience sucked because of it. And they fucked up by even releasing it on the older gens. But when they came out with the PS5 version, it was like the game I always wanted it. You know what I mean? I always wanted. You know what I mean? And it's finally that. And it's like, I really enjoy playing this game, dog. And hopefully on the next episode, we could talk about the Phantom Liberty DLC. I heard it's really good. Like, I heard it's really, really good. Like, there's a lot of, like, twists and plot twists and just a lot of different shit. The characters, the story, everything is, like, really well written. So I'm excited to dive into it, but I'll probably do that after I finish up Mirage, because I know I'm getting close to the end on that. But
okay.
Yeah, man. I'm trying to get Eknight to come back to play Cyberpunk.
No, it's not gonna happen.
Did you beat Starfield yet?
Nope. Man. I'm still playing. I'm just exploring, man. I told you. I'm like, I think I still have the pirate mission to do, and then I also have the main story to finish. But I've just been vibing out in the planets, and it's kind of relaxing actually, just vibing out in space. Like you can get up mid space travel, and I just kind of sit there and just look out there in the space on my ship,
mm-hmm.
vibing out, chilling.
Yeah, but
yeah.
Let's talk about this last subject real quick for y'all, man.
Ooh.
We talked about it on the last podcast. We talked about it on the podcast before then, and we're going to talk about it on this one and the next one because it's COD season, baby. It's Call of Duty season right now, dog.
Oh, I thought you meant the fish.
What fish?
COD.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Call of Duty season.
Yeah.
COD.
COD. Same thing. Fish.
COD season.
All right.
Call of Duty season. We're in Call of Duty season, baby. It's lit right now, dog. So, what was it? 2 weeks ago, the Modern Warfare 3 beta released on PlayStation 5, exclusively for PlayStation players. I think it was on 5 and 4.
Mm-hmm.
And it was exclusive for PlayStation people. And then the week after that, it was open to everybody on all systems if you pre-ordered. And then it was just open to everybody, regardless if you pre-ordered or not. And, you know, of course, I pre-ordered the game. I got the Vault Edition. $100, baby. Spent that $100 for the, what is it everybody's saying? The copy and paste. You're literally paying for the same game. Yeah.
We are. Yeah, no, I got in on the free to play beta. I didn't have to pay anything for once.
You didn't pre-order?
Mm-mm. No, so it was just free.
Let me see how your experience was. How'd you like it, man?
Modern Warfare 2 with different perk system, different... I like the hipfire mechanic that they brought back from the night missions. Because I was playing it, and I know Julio was playing it, and he was telling me like, oh, they took it from Apex. And I was like, no, this is from 2019 when they had the night missions, and when you put the night vision on, you get the laser sight and aim basically a hipfire type style. So yeah, I was like,
aim from the side.
Yeah, you aim from the side. It's
called canted.
Yeah, canted sights. That's what it is. But yeah, I like that system because it kind of matches my playstyle. I like to do a lot of hip firing. So I always build my guns in COD for like hip firing reactions. Cause most of the time I always get up getting jumped by some fucking sweat as going 3-speed. And I'm like, fuck, what do I do? And I just fire my gun and then just hope, like spray and pray and hope I kill this motherfucker before he kills me. But like, I like that system that they added. I like that. That's an option.
Yeah. To flesh out the system that he's talking about, not to cut you off. What he's talking about is when you're aiming down your sights, right? You're aiming down your sights, you can press, like, I think on PlayStation, it's like up on the D-pad or down on the D-pad. It's like really big on the screen. Something that people, that they've asked the developers to kind of make it smaller, make mm-hmm. it like a little less noticeable, because it is like pretty big on the fucking screen. And I did say they were going to fix that for the full release. They're going to make it a little smaller. But you can push a button and basically, instead of aiming down your sights, you can aim from the side and, like, you know, crosshair will pop up on the screen. Mm-hmm. And it's mainly for if you're using, like, let's say you're using a 4x scope.
Yeah.
And you're in close quarters combat. Now you don't have to try to fight people aiming down the sights with this, you know, 4x sight. You can just
so for the people for that aren't gonna quick scope with anything, essentially.
No,
but it's also for people who have long range sights on their guns.
Yeah.
So like if I'm running an LMG with a long range sight and I'm using the mounted mechanic and whatever and trying to snipe people with it, I can like quickly turn around, switch it to the canted sight, and then just spray and pray for close range combat. And it's also good if people are running up on you while you're aiming, because you can quickly switch to it. So I like this mechanic. I hope it stays.
It's all right. I haven't used it enough to be like, all right, I like this.
I've used it. I played the shit out of the 24/7. What's it called? High rise map.
Oh, okay.
By the way, all the locations that you can get up to are still there, which is good. Because I was a piece of shit and I got up on top of the roof and nobody could touch me. It works great for when you're turning the hallway with a. I just go canted sights and just spray and pray. I'm about to. Like, if I get the game when it's on sale, because that's pretty much how I feel about this game. It's Modern Warfare 2. It's got a new coat of paint, a couple new game mechanics, newish guns, oldish guns. Old maps are coming back from the old games, which is great. Fucking Ground War was hilarious to me because you could kill people with the goddamn helicopter blades through buildings and shit. So I would just grab one of those things. I would just plow into the enemy helicopter, get like 50 people on spawn until like I blew up or something funny.
I didn't play any Ground War.
You should have. It was hilarious. I do like some of the kill streaks that they added.
Did you play Cutthroat?
No, I did not.
That's a good game mode. That was like is a really good game mode. It's 3v3v3.
Yeah, I wanted to try it, but I didn't have time. So But the one kill streak I was gonna talk about was the Recon Juggernaut, and I was like, so they're kind of like giving players who are probably not that great at the game an option to get this kill streak, because it's like what, 8 kills for it or something?
Yeah, it's 8 kills.
Yeah, so it's like I was like, oh, okay, so it's like it's there in the area where it's not gonna be easy to get, but it's also attainable for like your average player.
Yeah,
and I'm like.
It's an alright kill streak too. It's not like bad. Like,
bro, it's just a juggernaut with a riot shield. You know, it's the most annoying character to fight against. I shot the shit out of this dude with an LMG and he would not go down. And then I like explosives and everything. He just was like, well, I have a riot shield. I can just ignore that shit. And I was like, this is some bullshit. But yeah. I think that's cool. I like how they redid the perk system for gear. I think that's a lot more, a little bit realistic, but it's also like it makes more sense and it makes building your loadouts a lot cooler rather than it's like, here's your perks. It's like, no, here's your clothing. And then it makes it more identifiable against who you're fighting against. Cause then you can like tell who's got what kind of perks on by like what kind of like what armor they're wearing or whatever.
Can you see that though? I didn't notice that.
Yeah, you can see if people are wearing ghillie suits and shit.
Oh, okay.
It physically changes what you look like.
I was playing as like the Captain Price in the Makarov skin, so
I don't change
with the gear.
Yeah, I don't know if like you got like a Nicki Minaj skin, it's gonna change. Like she's gonna be wearing a ghillie suit or some shit, or if that's just gonna be the skin. But if you're the default dude. You can see who's got like the ghillie suit on or like the heavier armor. It's then again, it's barely like noticeable for certain shit. Like obviously you're not gonna be like, oh, I can see what kind of gloves he's wearing. So he clearly has like tactical reload on. Like it's nothing like major, but it is like noticeable to a point to where if you're just default skinning, you're gonna have like all this stupid shit. Now it's just a small thing that I noticed that I thought was cool. I don't know if it's going to be like a way to metagame or anything later down the line or for like tournaments or anything, but I just thought it was a cool addition or a cool remix of the perk system. Other than that, yeah, it's Modern Warfare 2.5. I don't know what else to expect besides zombies and DMZ. And I'm not looking forward to downloading this game when I get it, because it's probably going to be like a 500 gig download.
Okay, so for that, right, because I was actually talking to somebody about that the other day. We're having a conversation because it seems like this Call of Duty is the one Call of Duty that where they're like, all right, you don't have to necessarily delete Modern Warfare 2, because if at least on PS5, if you look at the file breakdown, right, it's like, campaign is 28 gigabytes, Warzone is 3 gigabytes, and multiplayer is like the fucking 100 gigabytes. Multiplayer includes like, I think all the multiplayer stuff. So it's like, it's probably DMZ, and then Warzone is literally just Warzone. And for my PS5, it's literally 3 gigabytes. So it's like all together. If I have everything downloaded, co-op, campaign, multiplayer, and Warzone. It's like 140 gigabytes. The idea that I think that they're going with this Modern Warfare 3 is that it's only another 30 gigabytes on top of that. That's all it is like another 30 gigabytes on top of that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it's looking like. Like, because there's you can literally download files for the game right now, like pre-download shit. I don't know if it's for the campaign or what, but like there's some file that says it's 38 gigabytes from Modern Warfare 3. But they've already said, like, this is the one Call of Duty where they want you to be able to still play Modern Warfare 2, because to my knowledge, I think Warzone is getting an update to where Warzone is going to run in Modern Warfare 3 or whatever like that, like in the Modern Warfare 3 engine, because the engine is totally different. You know mm-hmm. what I mean?
Yeah.
Not really, but, you know, the movement's different. So I don't know. We'll have to see, man. My little short, sweet review is I'm excited. I ain't gonna lie to you. I'm excited.
Every Call of Duty ever.
I'm excited, dog. I'm excited. And like I said on two podcasts ago, this is going to be a top five Call of Duty. I feel it, dog.
I feel like it's going to be good for the community. It'll refresh a lot of things that got stale. And then, you know, you're getting DMZ. You're getting zombies along with DMZ.
I'm scared about DMZ, man. Like, I don't know what they – like, I don't know if you played DMZ since the Haunting update that came out.
I reinstalled Modern Warfare 2 to play the beta for 3, mm-hmm. and then I uninstalled it right after that. I told you last when I uninstalled the last time, I am done with Modern Warfare 2 for the time being. I will pick up Modern Warfare 3 when it's on sale. And to be honest with you, like, I'm not going to feel left out. It's not a game where I'm like, oh man, I wish I got that skin or whatever. It's a game where it's like, I can play it with my friends, fun, and then just leave.
I'm like that with a lot of my games too. Like, I'm like that with like Apex now, mm-hmm. Fortnite and all that shit. Like, I don't really care. I just like to play it with my friends. But with Duty, like, you're right. Like, I think, you know, because my community's kind of centered around Duty these days. And I think they're going to enjoy what we got going on with this with this new Duty. I like it a lot. Like, so this review is going to be totally different when it was just the PS5 open beta, because I'm not going to lie, the PS5 open beta got some of the worst mechanics ever. Like, it had me looking at this game like, I'm sick. I spent $100 on this game. Like, I was about to physically throw up. Like, I was sick, dog. Like, I was like, dog, this shit is fucking garbage, bro. I was like, this shit is fucking garbage. Because they changed a lot of things that I didn't like, dog. They changed, like, they made certain, like, all right, just so y'all know, this Call of Duty game is made by Sledgehammer. It's made by Sledgehammer. If you know Sledgehammer's track record, they made Advanced Warfare, Modern World War II, and then they did Vanguard. So not a really good track record, dog, right? And mm-hmm. they did do half of the original Modern Warfare 3 back in 2011, because Infinity Ward was working on the project, and then everybody from the original Infinity Ward left to now become what they are now, Respawn. But yeah, they don't have a really good track record. So I went into this like, dog, like I hope it still has the soul, because I'm one of those few people that really do like Modern Warfare 2. I thought Modern Warfare 2 was really good, like really good.
Like, on launch? Yeah, I think it was like, again, I felt the same way. I was like, it's 2019.
Yeah, because we literally set in on our end of the year review last year. We both said it, like, if fucking Elden Ring didn't come out, this would be like game of the year. You know what I mean?
And maybe I don't know.
Really, it felt that way.
Wasn't God of War also the same year as Elden Ring? So yeah, like,
but I didn't.
Really feel like
God of War.
I know, but I feel like
couple hours of it, but not enough to.
In
be
general,
like,
I feel like if it wasn't Elden Ring getting it, it was God of War and Call of Duty. Yeah. Like, if those games didn't come out, maybe Call of Duty probably would have.
We were
it.
Talking. I'm more so talking about for our personal opinions, like me and you.
Yeah, for
we
sure.
Both
like
said that, we both said, like, if Elden Ring didn't come out this year, it was definitely Modern Warfare 2, because I really liked Modern Warfare 2. So going into this Modern Warfare 3, I was like, all right, it's just going to be more of the same, hopefully. It sounds fucking stupid, but I was looking forward to this being just a copy and paste, new maps, new game modes, new stuff, with some updates to it.
I think the thing is with Call of Duty is that every generation of COD is like gets to the point where it's the same bullshit. We had it back when the original Modern Warfare came out. I was always saying Modern Warfare 3 is just copy and paste. It's the same game engine, same graphics. Yeah,
Modern Warfare 3 different models. Was literally a fucking copy and paste of Modern Warfare 2.
Yeah, so like it was to me, it's like I'm not worried. I don't think a game has to like I've evolved my opinion to the point where it's like I don't think a game has to have brand new game models, brand new engine, and all that shit for it to be good. It needs to do what it does well as making a couple new additions or revisions to older things to make it feel fresh. And I think with Modern Warfare 2 specifically and Modern Warfare 3, the transition, it's not going to be that crazy different. I think they're focusing on game modes and gameplay more than they're focusing on campaign or just like graphics or whatever. I think that's a smart decision. I think they should make sure the community gets what they want, and they should realize that all their communities need to be like, and it's the same thing with Halo. You got separate facets of the community, you got with COD. So like fucking for custom game dudes, it would be like fucking zombies or something. For DMZ dudes, it'd be like Forge. It'd be, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
You got these small subsections of your massive community that you need to please because you've introduced these mechanics to this community. So you should focus on delivering for all them.
And that's crazy you say that, dog, because this is the talk that me and all my boys have in the group chat all the time. We always talk about like the sentiment about this Call of Duty game. Like everybody's got their opinions on it. You know, like the people who play Call of Duty for a living, they love Modern Warfare 3. Like the people who play this shit for a living, they're like, this is the game we wish we got last year, this, that, and the third. I generally agree. Like when they were talking about all the changes they were doing to Modern Warfare 3, I was like, I felt like I could live without them until I got them back again. Because remember, like when we did the review of Modern Warfare 2 last year, I was saying like, yo, I was kind of sad that like slide canceling was gone. But then like halfway into me playing Modern Warfare 2, I was like, I really don't miss it that much. But now that I have it back again, it's like, my nigga, like this shit is fucking like combat just feels like way more fluid, dog. Especially if you have that one perk which allows you to aim while sliding. It's like, dog, this shit feels so fucking good. Like right. You can full on like slide cancel now. You can't do what you were able to do in like the older duties, like Vanguard, Cold War, 2019, where you could like, you cancel the slide with a jump and like jump up in the air and then go back into a slide. You can't do that, but it still feels very fucking fluid, dog. And like the one thing I'll say, from the original beta, not the open beta where it was open to everybody. I'll say the crossplay beta and the PlayStation only beta. And the PlayStation only beta, that was the saving grace for me, was the movement. I was like, this movement feels good, but this gunplay sucks. Cause like, I'm not gonna lie, dog. Like aim assist was fucking shit when the game dropped. When the beta dropped for PlayStation. Mm-hmm. And the equipment was fucking busted. Like the battle rage was broken. So if you don't know, guys, this Call of Duty, everybody has 150 health. Everybody has 150 health, right? Versus last year's Call of Duty multiplayer was only 100. So they have 50 more. But when you battle raged in Modern Warfare 3 on the like day one of the beta for the first 7 hours,
you got like a massive health boost.
You got 100 health, dog. It's crazy, dog. It was so busted, which it's like, I think the beta came out at 1 p.m. our time. By 7 o'clock, they fixed that shit. They were like, bro, like they nerfed battle rage to the point you can't even use it no more. Like there's no point in using it.
I feel like they should have kept the health boost, but I feel like it should have been something along the lines where it's like you Well, not like 150, maybe like an even 100 just to keep you alive, or maybe even 75. Because I know you get more HP in this Call of Duty right now, right? Because it's time to kill a bit longer. Yeah, so maybe 75 HP boost. Kept all the other extra effects, but I think there should have been like a you're fucked up for like 10 seconds or something like that cooldown for you. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because what people were doing at first was literally the just spawning, hitting the battle rage, and it lasts for 10 seconds and kills refreshed deep. So it was like, yo, it was like, bro, what the fuck were they thinking with this shit? But then I had to think, it's fucking Sledgehammer. They haven't had a good idea in forever. And then you got the Breacher drone as a fucking lethal. So instead of a Semtex or a grenade, you have a literal drone you can throw straight. You can literally throw straight like a throwing knife, and it'll fly and explode right in front of your enemy. Mm-hmm. As soon as it makes contact with him. I was like, bro, what are they thinking with this shit?
I don't know. That sounds like cool as shit, though. I'm not gonna lie.
It do, but it's dog. It's like, what are they thinking with this equipment? Then I didn't like in the beta that we didn't have access to stims, because I feel like this game would really feel good with stims. Like I said, like you just got done like taking somebody out. You're sliding and you stim real quick. You slide to another guy. You take him down with your gun and shit. It's like I think it's because
you have stims. More health that they probably find it more annoying for people to fight against people with stims.
Yeah, I know stims are gonna be in the full release though, but I don't know. In the beta, I wish we got them, but
I think they just wanted to focus on the new shit.
I will say, like, for the PlayStation only beta, like I said, the aiming was shit. The fucking aim assist was so bad, dog. Like it almost was like non-existent. Like I was saying the whole time I was playing the beta, like I should have bought this shit for PC. It would just been better, because I literally feel like I'm playing mouse and keyboard with a controller. It's fucking weird. But I knew what they were gonna do by the time the crossplay beta came out. And it was open to everybody. They fixed the aim assist. It was a lot more sticky, a little bit more snappy. Not as snappy as it is on Modern Warfare 2, but I think that's like the point, because everybody complained about how strong aim assist was in Modern Warfare 2, because it is really fucking strong. It's fucking ridiculous how strong it is. But yeah, man, I enjoyed the beta, dog. Long story short, I enjoyed the beta. The guns are good. We finally got the OG ACR is back. It feels good to have my baby back. It's just, I enjoyed the beta, man. I'm ready for the full game. The campaign early access starts the 2nd, so you'll be able to play the story mode on the 2nd, and then the full game is out the 10th of November. I can't wait, dog. Dude. And zombies looks good. I'm excited for zombies. Like, and just so you know, zombies is a totally different experience from DMZ, because at first they made it seem like zombies was going to be in DMZ, and they're like, nah, zombies is its own thing, and DMZ is still its own thing. I'm just worried about what they're going to do with DMZ moving forward. It doesn't seem like they're going to focus on it as much, but it does seem like all the new content that Warzone gets, most of it DMZ will get, so that I'm happy with that. I'm happy with that.
Okay.
Long story short, I really liked the fucking beta. It was fun. It's fun.
Yeah, I think it was enjoyable. It was just Modern Warfare 2 with different. Everything's remixed.
And I did like the perks. Like you were right about the perks. Like the perks were really good. Like
they make more sense now. Sneakers.
Yeah, like
Dead Silence is on sneakers now. You got explosive resistance on your vests and shit.
Yeah.
Reload aiming shit is on your gloves. I think that's a better balance. Now I can be wrong when the game comes out.
Two suck. The perks in Modern Warfare 2 were just
I like hated the perk shit. Package shit. I hated that because it literally was like you can only have this perk with this perk, and I'm like, that's fucking stupid. Let me customize it. And I think this system's a lot better because now you can. It's like, oh, I can't have tack reload and then also rapid reload at the same time. It's like they gotta choose one or the other, but it still will go with like the rest of the kit. And it'll be a little bit more balanced, so that way you're not doing like crazy shit like back in the old days. It's like one man army.
Yeah, like you gotta either choose to be stealthy or have a longer tax sprint. Like, I like that too, dog. Yeah. I didn't notice until you said it. I was like, you know what? He's right about the perks. Like, the perks feel really good. They feel really, really good. Overall, I'm excited. We'll give you like a full-on, because I really didn't play too much of the beta. I played the new cutthroat mode. I really enjoyed it. I'm going to be playing a lot of it when the full game comes out. I'm going to probably do a 24-hour stream or like a 48-hour stream when duty drops. I'm not going to lie. Mm-hmm. And we're going to really grind that game out. But yeah, man, just catch me on twitch.tv/BlazeXEnferno. You already know what it is, man. But that's all we got for you for today's show, man. Today was just a review. We're going to talk about some things. Hopefully we got you guys to, you know what I mean, maybe look at some of the games you already own. That's kind of what this episode is about. Like, Halo's been out. Cyberpunk's been out. You know what I mean? Those are two games you can go back to. Mirage is cheap. Ish, it's like 50. I think by Black Friday it'll be even cheaper than
that. I think it's a game you can just wait till it's on sale.
Yeah, exactly. But you know, more so, this episode is just kind of, we really wanted to talk about Halo because Eknight loves Halo, man.
I love Halo. That's I don't know if you guys know.
That's the title for this podcast too.
Eknight loves Halo. Fuck the Modern Warfare beta. It's all about Halo.
Yeah, go play Halo. The beta was dope, man. I'm not going to lie to you. At first, I was like, I was ready to hate on this game. They fucked
it
up.
I think the other thing it was it, the beta.
Did a good job, man.
It was just a bit buggy, but that's like to be expected. So like,
yeah, it was a bit buggy, but it was it.
I know.
Like I said, the guns, they just need to tweak them up a little bit, just a little bit, and I think it'll be perfect.
In my humble opinion, I think when next time they run the beta, I think they shouldn't do levels unlocks. I think they should just have everything unlocked.
Yeah, they. I don't even want to talk about that because it was weird with that shit, man.
Yeah. But I do want to note that one of the funnier bugs was that it would crash my friend's or Julio's Discord every time he played that or tried to stream it on the Discord to show me stuff. And I was like, I see a black screen. And then he would crash. And I was like, oh, shit. I mean, I didn't have that issue when I was playing it, but it was funny though to me.
Yeah, we'll see when the full game comes out. I'm excited to see because we only had a limited pool of maps. Like, what were the ground war maps? Do you remember?
It was only one map, but it was a decently sized map. There was a lot of like it was like warehouses type, some like trailers.
Do you know what it was called?
I forget, but it was a decently it was big and
okay.
There was a lot of like there's a lot of cover to cover. There was like an under like a river sewer system thing they had going on for some certain sections of the map.
Okay.
I will tell you that it plays exactly like Ground War from Modern Warfare 2, which is why I was like, it's just 2.5. It's
okay.
I think vehicle combat is still stiff and floaty. And they need to raise the skybox for the helicopters. I'm just going to tell you that now. You got like a bunch of motherfuckers with rocket launchers on the map that they can spawn in with. But you need to like, you need to raise the sky ceiling so that way we can do like high Halo drops and shit. Like I was sitting here like just sniping people off the helicopter and then they were just like, it was like, you were like, I want to say 60 feet off the ground at the top of the skybox. Yeah. It's not even that high. So I feel like they need to raise that up a bit. I think they need to introduce like actual new vehicles. I don't know what they're introducing for Warzone, but I think they need to just introduce new, interesting vehicles, like get a little creative with it. Because those can carry over to Warzone. But yeah, this has been episode 71 of the Infernal Gaming Podcast.
You already know, baby. Yeah, we about to end this showing up, man.
Shortest podcast I think we've done.
Maybe. I don't know. We still might have a nice little time limit on this, but we'll see. But we hope you enjoyed this episode as always. Make sure when you do watch this episode, wherever you watch it on all of the platforms that's out there, you rate it if you can on Spotify and Apple. And if you're watching on YouTube, make sure you thumbs up. Leave a comment. Let us know what you like, what you think we should talk about. The next episode is going to be kind of interesting, man, because the next episode, Modern Warfare 3 will be out. So we'll be talking about Spider-Man.
I'm going to be flaming about the campaign, probably. I'll be like, this campaign sucks and I didn't even play it.
Yeah, we'll see, man. But this has been episode 71 of the Inferno Gaming Podcast, man. It's your boy, BlazeDxENFERNO. My guy, Eknight117. We out of this bitch.
All right.
Peace out.
Bye.